start in going through the book of Matthew. The book of Matthew. We're going to pick up. With the story or a section of scripture right after Jesus was tempted for 40 days. He defeats the enemy. What I mean by that is the enemy came with all the temptation. Jesus did not give in to one of them. And the scripture says that he overcame the temptation by speaking the scripture. He says, it is written. And by the end of the time where Jesus is declaring it is written, the Bible says that the devil left. And there's another portion of scripture that says he left for another opportune time. What it was saying is he left, but he was coming back. So that was the beginning of the war. And you got to be thinking about life when Jesus came to earth. What did he come for? He came to fight for souls for eternity. He came here with a mission, and his mission was every single one of us. We needed to be rescued. This world needs to be rescued. So he came to save us from the bondage or the slavery of sin. He came to save us from the judgment over sin. He came to save us from our pain, hurt, and suffering. And he came to save us and give us eternal life. And that was going to be a war that would require his life. So Jesus starts off his ministry in a battle with the devil, but he continues fighting this battle for every single one of us. So let's go ahead and look at Matthew chapter 4, and we'll start off with verse 12, and we're just going to read verse 12 through verse 17, so it's going to be five scriptures, and we're going to go verse by verse on these scriptures, but we're going to, you know, realistically, if we weren't going verse by verse, you would look at these scriptures and maybe just skip over them, but there's a lot of important details in these portions of scripture that we're going to read today. So let's look at that. Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. And this is what it says. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he left Judea and returned to Galilee. He first went to Nazareth, then left there and moved to Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This fulfilled what God said through the prophet Isaiah in verse 15. In the land of Zebulun and of Naphtali, besides the sea beyond the Jordan River in Galilee, where so many Gentiles live, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who lived in the land where death casts a shadow, a light has shined. From then on, Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Now, when we look at this scripture, you say, whoa, what are you going to talk about that? Because it just looks like a whole bunch of descriptions of where Jesus lived and the condition of a few people. But in this portion of scripture, we'll start with the first verse. In the first verse, we see that Jesus, when Jesus heard that John had been arrested. Now, what this portion of scripture is all about is, if I had to define or give a title of this message, it would be this: the war for souls. Now, John the Baptist is he's arrested, and little later we read in scripture, he was not only arrested, he was beheaded. His head was cut off. Now, why was his head cut off? They were trying to do everything they could to shut John up. They didn't want to hear his message. Why didn't they want to hear his message? Because his message convicted them of their sins. And this is what it convicted them and challenged them to repent of their sins. I believe that we're living in a society today that realistically, sometimes we don't want to hear truth. And what we want to do, if we can, silence the voice of truth any way we can. There's even those that today would even try to silence God and say he doesn't exist. Why would someone want to silence God or just take him out of the equation? There's a reason. They don't want to hear what he has to say. And the easiest way for me and you to continue living a life that's not accountable to God or not pleasing to God is do this. Just go ahead and eliminate the messenger and eliminate the message and eliminate God. But we could do that all in our minds. You could kill John the Baptist. You could arrest him. But the truth is still the truth. And people still need to hear this good news message. Why would someone continue preaching this message? The reason they continue preaching this message is because they're in a war for souls. So how do we fight for souls? I want to give you some insights. Number one, get through the resistance and persecution in order to get to the person. Now Jesus sees that John the Baptist is arrested. Where is he arrested? He's arrested in Galilee. Now, where is Jesus headed? Jesus is headed to Galilee. You would think that Jesus would be going the opposite direction. He's actually moving towards, I would even say this, towards the war zone. John the Baptist is arrested. There's major resistance in the city. Persecution has now begun. The war for souls has begun. John the Baptist has been arrested. Now, if I heard that someone was arrested in the city, maybe as in our human nature would say, I'm not going to the battle zone or the war zone. I'm going to get away from that city. But Jesus went towards that city. Now, in that region of Galilee, there was a lot of villages, over 200 villages that had over 15,000 people approximately in each village. You know what that meant? There was over 3 million people in that area. And Herod was the king at that time. And he was the one that arrested John the Baptist. And what he wanted to do was silence the voice of God in his life. Now, you could silence maybe John the Baptist, but Jesus is saying, you can't stop this message and you can't stop me from reaching those 3 million people. And I'm going into that city, and what John began, I'm going to go ahead and finish. Are there any brave people in the house that are willing to go through some persecution to get to a soul? Now, in the Bible, it says this, that followers or believers will be persecuted. Now, we don't talk too much about persecution here in America, because in America, you don't have major persecution. But in other countries, you do have major persecution. There are people even today that are Muslim countries that if they actually preach the gospel publicly, they're in danger of dying or being stoned to death or being killed or being arrested. Right now, even in China, there's Christians that are arrested for preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. There's a lot of churches now in the world that are underground churches. They don't have the freedom like we do in America to go ahead and preach the good news. But the reason it's important for you to understand, Christians are persecuted for their message and their lifestyle, because I really believe, and I think this is really prophetically, and I think the writing's on the wall, I really believe that in America, persecution is knocking at our door. Some of the laws that are being put into place are anti-Christ or anti-scripture. And what are we going to do? Are we just going to go ahead and agree with society, agree with the immorality, agree with the lower standards? Or are we going to say, no, that's not true. This is what God said, and he hasn't changed his mind. His standards are still the same. Now, the moment we begin to fight for souls, we're also showing people through our preaching, and we're showing people through our lifestyle, the standards of God. Now, either someone's going to say, yeah, man, I love those standards, or because they want to stay in their lifestyle, they'll begin to resist those standards. And that's when persecution comes. Let me read to you about persecution. So John the Baptist was arrested. Why? Because of his message and his lifestyle. In 2 Timothy 3:12, it says this, Indeed, all who delight in pursuing righteousness and are determined to live godly lives in Christ Jesus will be hunted and persecuted because of their faith. Think about that. The scripture promises us that if we're focused on winning souls, living for Christ, the scripture promises this, that there will be some resistance. And if we can't get through the resistance or the persecution, and our persecution might be some of our family members talking about us. Our persecution might be someone telling you, you're way too religious. Are you part of a cult or what? Our persecution might be that some of your friends or associates start bagging on you, talking about you, or say, you know what? I don't even want to be in relationship with you anymore. You're going off the deep end. But there is some persecution if we begin to stand up for Christ. Today in the schools, now if you're a student, whether you're going to a high school or you're going to a university, there will be resistance there. I remember when I was going to Cal State San Bernardino, they said, I was in a communications class, and they said this, you, Marco, or everybody in the class, could talk about whatever you want. And I just knew as a believer that if you're giving me the leeway to talk about anything I want, well, I'm going to go ahead and talk about Jesus. And I began to share the good news of Jesus Christ, that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but have eternal life. And then I said, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father but through him. So I spoke that. Now, right before me, there was a Muslim young lady that spoke about her faith. So she spoke about her faith. I spoke about my faith. After she spoke about her faith, everybody clapped. After I spoke about my faith, nobody said a word. So I said, any questions? No one had any questions but the teacher. So the teacher raised her hand to put me on the spot. And she says, Marco, let me hear you correctly. Are you saying that she is not going to heaven because she doesn't believe in Jesus? Now, I was put on the spot because nowadays, the pressure would say, well, I don't know, or we'll find out at the end, or maybe all paths lead to the same address. But we all know that all paths don't lead to the same address. So someone is going to have to stand up and say the truth. The truth is, there's only one name to call on to be saved. There's only one name to call on to be forgiven. There's only one name to call on to have eternal life. And his name is Jesus. There's no other way to the Father but through the Son. And you might say, why? Because Jesus is the one that dealt with our sin problem. We sinned, and the wage of sin is death. And what did Jesus do? He died in our place. Buddha didn't do that. Muhammad didn't do that. None of the Hindu gods did that. There's only one that died for our sins, and his name is Jesus Christ, and he loved us so much, and he came to earth over 2,000 years ago to fight for souls. So I'm in that room, and now I'm fighting for souls. The pressure's on me. What are you going to say, Marco? I'm all by myself. I'm not in church. I don't have no backup. I don't have an amen corner. By myself. And I had to say, well, you're asking me a question, and I'm going to answer you by what the Bible says. And the Bible says that she can receive and believe in Jesus Christ and be saved. And so can you. But if you refuse the help, If you refuse to believe in the Savior, then she and everyone else will be condemned for eternity. And I stopped. And I said, any other questions? And that teacher was just pierced. So what you're telling me is, and then she said it again, that she's not going to heaven. And I said, no, I'm not telling you. The Bible's telling you. And after I was done, I go, any other questions? She goes, no. And then I just sat down. There was a Christian in that classroom that after class, he said, I really appreciate you being bold. And I was like saying, where were you? But there is going to come a time that if we're willing to reach one soul, one family, that we're going to have to get through the persecution to get to the person. I'll say it again. We're going to have to get through the persecution to get to the person. Every time we're going out to reach a city, reach a person, reach a family, there will be resistance. John the Baptist faced resistance. Jesus faced resistance. And the Bible promises us we will face resistance. It's just part of the war for a soul. So we keep on looking. I just want to read another scripture on persecution for a minute, and which is our second point that we're going to be making. So our first point was, how do we fight for a soul? Number one, get through the resistance of persecution. Say with me, get through the resistance of persecution. Don't be surprised there's persecution. Don't be surprised there's resistance. Get through it to get to the person. It's worth it. Jesus did it, and so are we called to do it. Number two, way that, how do we fight for a soul? Number two, don't let your faith, love, or attitude be conquered. Don't let your love, or attitude be conquered. In Matthew 5:10, it says this, God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. So Jesus starts off his ministry and he's talking about, hey, we're going to go out there and I'm going to make you fishers of men. You're going to go out there and reach one for 2021. You're going to reach one person, you're going to reach a family. But I want to warn you, there will be resistance and you will be persecuted. But I've set this up that if you are persecuted and you run into resistance, this is what's going to happen. I will bless you, and the full power of the kingdom of heaven will be accessible to you. So when you're going through persecution, you're going through resistance, because you're living right, because you have the right message in your mouth, understand this. You're going to be in the most powerful place you've ever been. I will back you up, and I will supremely bless you in the middle of your fight. I love that. What he's saying is, when you go out there and fight for a soul, don't forget, my blessings are with you. My power is with you. My kingdom is with you. That's why they will not be able to conquer you. Don't, and I'm going to say this, they won't be able to conquer you, but be careful that the persecution doesn't conquer your attitude, doesn't conquer your love. Let's keep on reading. It says, God blesses you when people mock you. Someone says, I want to live the blessed life. Okay. God blesses you when people what? Mock you. Think about that. And persecute you. And lie about you. And say all sorts of evil things against you. Because you are my followers. Whoa. Do you mean that God blesses me when people lie about me? They talk about me. They persecute me, they dog me. He's saying, when they do that, understand, what they're doing to you is not going to override my blessing upon you. God is saying, they can do that, but don't you forget, I'm going to bless you massively when that happens. After persecution comes blessings and rewards. Say it with me. After persecution comes what? And rewards. Let's keep on reading. It says, be happy about it. Be very glad for a great reward awaits you in heaven. And remember, the ancient prophets were persecuted in the same way. And the scripture is saying that every single person that has ever been a spokesman for God has experienced resistance and eventually will experience some persecution. But don't you forget, at the end, you're going to be rewarded massively. You're going to get great rewards from God, and God's blessing is upon your life. So in order to reach a soul, we can't let our faith, love, and attitude be conquered. So the Bible says, be glad or be happy. It doesn't say be angry or be hateful or be bitter or be vengeful or be prideful or be discouraged or be a victim or be sad or be doubtful, etc., etc., etc. It says be happy. What he's saying is a big part of you reaching people is having the right attitude. A big part of reaching people is to continue being loving. The big part of reaching people is still having faith that it's worth it all at the end. Because they're going to say, we persecuted you and you're still fighting for me? Man, what you're believing must be real. I remember when I was in the car business, there was a young man that was my friend. I befriended him and I led him to the Lord. His name was Robert Wallace. And I found out today, Robert Wallace died of cancer. So my friend, Robert Wallace, he was such a good friend that when I moved to Banning, and when I just got married, me and Liza and him, he actually moved in the house with us. And we were roommates in the home. And we were in a car business together. I led him to the Lord. Well, I started discipling him. And one of the things that I shared with him is to share his faith. Just like we're talking about today. We're car salespeople, but we're fighting for souls. And our field, our harvest is all the people we're working with. So Robert Wallace, I showed him some Bible tracts. And in these Bible tracts, they would tell a story. And then it would say a prayer to lead someone to Jesus. Well, Robert Wallace left that prayer or Bible tract in the bathroom. Now he leaves it in the bathroom, and I know why he left it in the bathroom. He left it in the bathroom so people could read it. And who knows, someone might get saved in the bathroom. But the person that went in right after he left that track was the general sales manager of the store. He goes in that bathroom. He reads it. He's Jewish. He reads it. And he gets massively offended. We're talking about persecution. We're talking about resistance. We're talking about a war for souls. He's in charge of the whole store. And it happens to be Friday morning. Friday morning, we have a huge sales meeting. There's like 40 people in the room with this big, huge conference table. I'm sitting at the table. All the whole staff sitting at the table, and the general manager comes in and he's red and he's angry. He's so angry, he jumps on the conference table and he starts screaming, and all the screaming came right at me, because he figured if there's anybody that left this Bible track here, it's him. He's the one that's public about his faith. So he stands up on the table, spitting and angry, points his finger at me, and he says, you. And he takes the Bible tract, throws it at me. Keep this stuff, this garbage out of the dealership. Keep this church stuff out of the dealership. It's offensive. And he told me this. Do you promise me that you'll never, ever bring this stuff into the dealership ever again? Well, first of all, I didn't bring it into the dealership, but I didn't get into that. That wasn't the point. Right? So he looks at me. The whole sales staff is now looking to see what I'm going to do. It's quiet. You can hear a pin drop. And I said, Holy Spirit, help me. What should I say? And then the Holy Spirit gave me something to say. And his name was Kenny. I go, Kenny, I can't promise you that I'll leave this stuff out of the dealership, because I love you too much for that. I'm concerned about your soul. And when I said that, the whole staff looked at me, and then they just all started clapping. Like, that was a good answer. They all started clapping, and he didn't know what to do, because they all started clapping, and then he goes, I wish you had those answers for your customers. But this is what happened next. It was maybe months later that he really sinned. He got one of the sales girls pregnant. And now this could turn into a major lawsuit to the company. He would now have to pay major child support. That'd be the least that was going to happen. And his life, supposedly, he thought was ruined. But guess who he called into that office? He called the guy and says, keep this stuff out of the dealership. And when he brought me in the office, I could have said, are you sure you want this? It's in the dealership. But I didn't. I went in there. He just started crying. I was able to share the good news of Jesus Christ with him. I was able to pray with him through his tough time. But I needed to go through the persecution. I needed to go through the difficulties. And I needed to make sure that I didn't let my faith, my love, and my attitude be conquered. It would have been real easy for me to be angry instead of happy and glad and still keeping faith and still keeping a good attitude. He knew that he gave me his best shot, and love was still there. Faith was still there. A good attitude was still there. I was still for him. So it gave an opportunity for me to start witnessing to him. Now, if we're going to reach one for 2021, understand there will be some resistance. Why am I telling you this? Because when there's resistance, don't be shocked. It's just part of the war for a soul. You guys get that? So number three is, how do we fight for a soul? Number one was, get through the resistance of persecution. Number two, don't let your faith, love, and attitude be conquered by anyone. Because once you're angry and you're upset and you're unforgiven, you cannot be an effective soul winner, because something has conquered your attitude. That's why the devil works with us getting offended. And understand, some of the things we call persecution aren't persecution. It's just a difficulty. If your brother or sister, you know, you guys don't get along, that's not persecution. That's just relationships. That's just part of the territory of forgiving people, loving your brothers and sisters. Persecution comes from the enemy. We as brothers and sisters, we go to trials, tribulations, and difficulties together, but it's not persecution, it's just relationships. You guys understand that? But if our attitude gets conquered by bitterness, anger, politics, whatever it is, this is what's gonna happen. You can't be an effective soul winner because you're now a prisoner of war. So don't become a prisoner of war. When people treat you bad, just be very glad about it and understand this, blessings are being released upon your life. Number three, be willing to go into the war zone. So Jesus doesn't let the threat of persecution deter him from going into Galilee. Why? There's 3 million souls are at stake. Persecution does not stop Jesus to going into the war zone. We as a church have to understand that the lost aren't going to be in the church unless we bring them. We go to the war zone. We go to the neighborhoods. We go to the homes. I remember one time I went into the war zone. I went into the war zone at my family get together. How many believe that sometimes your family get-togethers are the hardest place to witness? Like, everybody knows you. I remember, and they, you know, they're all opinionated. They'll tell you to shut up. They're family. And I remember that I went to this big, huge Christmas party, and I go with my cousin, and I go, and my cousin's name is Marcus. I'm Marco. His name's Marcus. I go, Marcus, this is what we're gonna do. We gotta preach. We gotta preach the gospel to our family. They're lost. It's Christmas time. Christmas is about Jesus is the reason for the season, right? So we're ready to go in there. And he goes, well, how do we do it? I go, they love music. They love salsa music. They love music. There's a song that, you know, it was a song by a group called the Latinos. And the name of the song was What Will You Do When the Party's Over? And I had a little cassette tape. We can't sing that good, but let's do this. Let's let the whole family know we want to do like some karaoke. We want to sing. So we put on the song, What Will You Do When the Party's Over? And the song's something like this. I don't remember the words, but I'm going to try my best. It goes, what will you do when the party's over? What will you do when the party's over? I know you think you're having fun. The party feels so right. But it goes something like this. But one day Jesus Christ is coming back. Are you going to be ready or not tonight? Something like that. I just made up the rest of it. But the idea was, after we were done, there was like a pin drop. You could hear nothing. The party's, it's just, the Holy Spirit hit our family. We're now in the war zone. And now I could feel the Spirit of God took over the party. And now and then the Holy Spirit says, tell them about me, that I'm the answer. Tell them about me, that I'm the Savior. Tell them about me, that they could be saved and have eternal life. And you know what we did? We had a, right there in that party, we had an altar call. And this is what happened that day. The majority of my family, they raised their hands just like in church, and they gave their life to Jesus, and they never forget that day because we were willing to go into the war zone. Now, Jesus went into the war zone, and we see this portion of scripture, and let's look at, he went first to Nazareth, then in verse 13, and left there and moved to Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee and the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This fulfilled what God said through the prophet in the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, beside the sea beyond the Jordan River in Galilee, where so many Gentiles live. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who lived in the land where death casts its shadow, a light has shined. So we see this, and we're going to end it with this. What was the condition of the people? The condition of the people in this city, in Galilee, or in this region, they were sitting in darkness, number one. They were sitting in darkness. That means that they were in a place that they weren't walking through darkness. They were in the darkness. That means that they were in a place of spiritual blindness they couldn't see. They were in a place of deep depression that they couldn't get out. They were in a place of spiritual darkness. That means that the enemy had power over them. They were ruled by a spirit or the prince of darkness. They were in an addiction that was so dark, torment that was so dark that they couldn't break out of it. They were in spiritual darkness. The other condition was that there was a shadow of death that was looming over them. And you know what that means? Not only were they in sin and ignorant of their condition, they didn't even realize how serious their condition was, but they had darkness looming over them. You know what that meant? Death was looming over them. What that meant was judgment was in their future. They had judgment upon their head. I want to read this last scripture here. And it's in Revelation 20, 12. These people were under a death sentence. And I want you to think about this as we're going out there reaching souls. They're in the same place. They're sitting in darkness, and this is the word that describes darkness, ignorant. That means they just don't know unless we tell them. And they also are under a judgment of death or a penalty of death. They don't even know judgment is coming. We love them. Like I told Kenny, I love you too much to not let you know, Kenny. And I thank God I let Robert Wallace know. Robert Wallace passed today. But I do know this, that I will see my buddy in heaven because of a conversation that we had here on earth. And I had to go through the war. I had to go through the difficulty. I had to go through the resistance. I had to not let my attitude be shaken. And I had to be willing to go in the war zone to reach somebody that was in this condition. And Revelation 20:12, it says this. I saw, check this out, there's a future. And I want you to think about this. This is the future for sure. I saw the dead, both great and small, standing before God's throne, and the books were opened. What this means, this is pointing to a prophetic picture of the judgment of mankind. Everyone, both great and small, what it means is rich, poor, powerful, weak, old, young. This is the future. One day, this will be everyone you know's reality. This is history written. It's a future, but it's historically already written. We're getting a picture of something that's going to happen. It's for sure. But look at this. And the books were open, including the book of life. So there's books in heaven that actually account for every moment of our lives, every detail of our life, every thought of our lives, and the book of life. And the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up its dead. So those that died at sea are now standing before God. There's people that have thrown ashes out in the sea. Every one of them are now standing before God. Death and the grave gave up their dead. So every tomb, every gravesite, every single person is now standing before God on this day called the Judgment Day, or the Great White Throne Judgment. And all were judged. I want you to get there. They're judged according to their deeds. In verse 14, then death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. This lake of fire is a second death. And anyone whose name was not found recorded in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Now, this is a future day that every single one of your friends and your relatives and everyone here that's watching, but God loves you so much. In the end of this chapter, he preaches, or he shines light. Jesus shines light. He shines light in this dark place. He shines light while these people have a shadow of death or have judgment over them. And how does he shine light? He shines light through a simple message. And all he says is really simply, he says this. He says, for then on Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. So Jesus gives a two-point sermon. He's in this area that's full of darkness. Galilee was interesting because it's a lot like America. It was a fertile land. That means that the farmers always had a big harvest. It was a land that looked very prosperous. It was a beautiful land that was near the sea. There's 3 million people living in this land. They're not hungry, they're prosperous. Everything looks really beautiful. It's a land under the Roman government, beautiful land, but yet they're beautiful, but they're lost. They're prosperous, and it's possible to be successful and beautiful and still be lost. So Jesus is going to this place, and he doesn't describe it as a beautiful place. he describes it as a place, the darkness, shadow of darkness is there. I mean, of death is there. And they're sitting in darkness. But the scripture says that light came. Jesus came. The light of the world came to preach to them, to save them, to give them eternal life, to save them from their condition. Jesus continues to do that through us. But how did he do it? A very simple message. He just said this: repent and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near, or it's here. What he was saying is, your breakthrough's here, your healing's here, your restoration's here, your new beginning is here, and all you have to do is be willing to turn from your sin, repent of your sins, and turn to me. Turn to Jesus. And this is what he said. Anyone that believed that and acted on that and was willing to give up their dark life and be willing to give up their leader that was over their life, which was Satan at that time, they could have a new king that loves them. They could have a new king that's called the Prince of Peace. They could have eternal life. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. They could be forgiven of every single sin they've ever committed. Wow, that's all great news. And all they had to do was say yes. And many people in that area gave their life to Jesus today and believed in Jesus that day. Yes, Herod was there trying to stop it, but there was nothing that was going to stop Jesus from reaching that area, even killing John the Baptist and arresting him. And this is what God is saying. There's people that we're called to reach. And let's go out there and reach them for the glory of God. If you're here, let's all stand up. You're home, you're here, let's all stand up. And we're going to go ahead and say a simple prayer. And let's look at this historical event where Jesus goes into a region called Galilee. There's 3 million people doing business. And Jesus is going there, and there's crowds that are going to begin to surround him as he's preaching. John the Baptist is arrested. There's a lot of turmoil happening. They're getting ready pretty soon to kill him, John the Baptist. Now Jesus is coming, preaching the same exact message. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You might have arrested John the Baptist, but you're not going to stop us from reaching you. We love you too much. We'll put our lives on the line. Hey, Kenny, I love you too much to keep this stuff out of our conversation. I won't do it. Robert Wallace, I loved you too much for us to be friends and not me mention Jesus Christ. And I'll see you again in heaven for eternity. I am so glad. I am so glad that that class, I don't know who got saved that day, but I'm so glad that that class, that even though it was pressure and it was difficult and it was hard, and I felt almost like a dummy after it was all said and done, they heard the good news of Jesus Christ. The seeds were planted and we were able to get through the resistance, continue loving people, and even be able to go into war zone for just one soul. And right now, I've gone through a war zone. Your friends have gone through a war zone for you. And we're going to go to reach them. Yes, there'll be resistance, but it'll be worth it. God will bless you and there'll be great rewards. If you want to give your life to Jesus and you're saying, Pastor, I feel like I'm sitting in death. I'm struggling. I feel like I'm sitting in it. I'm sitting in the depression. I can't get up. I can't overcome it. My heart is broken. I am struggling in this addiction. I feel like I'm tormented at night. I'm suicidal. I know there's something missing in my life. I can't even sleep at night. I am struggling. I feel like I've failed. It's okay. We've all failed. It's okay. We've all sat in darkness thinking there's no hope. Yes, there is. Jesus come to you in your darkness, not to judge you, but to save you. He loves you. He paid the price. He put his life on the line. He died for you to give you eternal life. You could have it today. Or maybe you feel like, man, there's gloom over my life. Like death is a shadow over me. I know if I were to die right now, I wouldn't make it to heaven. But I want to give my life to Jesus. Bow your heads, close your eyes, and repeat after me. Say this: Jesus, I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I realize that I'm in darkness. I'm asking you to set me free. Make me a new person. Jesus, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I receive the free gift of eternal life. I'm saved. I'm born again. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Let's give everyone a hand that just said that prayer. And right now in the home, if someone said that prayer, you said that prayer and I meant it. I just gave my life to Jesus. I recommitted my life to Jesus. I want you to raise your hand at home and just say, that's me. This is my brand new day. Jesus came to rescue me in my home today. I was sitting in darkness. I felt like there's gloom over my head. But today, I've made a decision. I'm believing in Jesus, and I will follow him for the rest of my life. And now you're also saying, I'm going to go into this war to win some souls, win my family for Jesus Christ. Don't be ashamed. Stand up for Christ. It's worth it all. There'll be blessings and great rewards now and for eternity. But before we go ahead and dismiss, this is what I want to do. Let's open up our homes for a time of prayer, just for a couple, for 2 minutes. 2 minutes. And this is a time, as you're there with your family or you're there with your friends, ask them, what do you want prayer for? Does anybody need prayer? Is anybody going through something? Does anybody need healing? Because we're believing that same Jesus that went to the war zone and conquered every single thing that you're facing is there in that room with you. He's fighting for your health. He's fighting for your salvation. He's fighting for your family. He wants to heal you. But this is how God does it. He does it through prayer. So we're going to sing one more worship song. And in this song, let's do this. Let's pray for one another. This is really good. I believe there's going to be miracles. People are going to be set free. Don't be ashamed either. Let's make our house a house of worship and a house of prayer. Let's do it right now. Let's pray for breakthrough today. Let's sing this song and then we'll dismiss right after it.
You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, sing it out. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Pray that right now that every single prayer that was made today in faith, this is what it's going to do. It's going to produce miracles. Thank God right now for the breakthrough that you got today. Thank God for his word that he's saying, well, I'm ready. I'm ready to go out there and reach one for 2021. And yes, I'm going to be willing to get through the resistance and persecution to reach one. I'm not going to let my love, my faith, or my attitude be conquered. I'm going to continue loving. I'm going to continue believing, and I'm going to continue being grateful, thankful, and have a joyous attitude. And I'm willing, that's right, to go into the danger zone or the war zone. Some of us are going to be sent out as missionaries to areas that are difficult and dangerous, but we're going to be willing to go out there in the danger zone, in the war zone, to reach one for 2021. God's with you. He loves you. I'm proud of you. Let's continue sharing our faith and inviting people to our watch parties. We'll be here this Sunday. We'd love to see you. God bless you. Remember this, if God is for you, there's no one that could come against you. Love you guys.